And now, it's time for another Dice Tower Review with Tom Vasel.
Hey everybody, I'm Tom Vasel. And today we're taking a look at the Palace of Mad King Ludwig. Now, just to clarify things, in case you're confused, there already is a game called The Castles of Mad King Ludwig. They're very different games. They are not in any way, you can't put them together. They're not similar. They're very different games. In The Castles of Mad King Ludwig, each person is building their own castle. In The Palace of Mad King Ludwig, you're building one palace altogether. It's a tile-laying game. Similar a little bit like the Carcassonne, it's very different, but you're placing square tiles down and trying to score the most points. And here's how it's done. Each player has their own blueprint board that they're going to put in front of them that shows you your color and your symbol, and you have a bunch of tokens of your symbols. This is the main board, and as you can see, there's all sorts of pieces all over it. This is where the castle is going to be built. So you're going to need to leave a bunch of space in the middle of the table. You're going to have three random hallways placed there, and players are going to be slowly building the castle. On your turn, you have several options. One of the things you can do is you can build a room. So you can see here that there are six rooms for you to build from. You can pick any of the rooms. However, if you pick these rooms, you have to pay swans. Swans are a type of currency, although they're also points at the end of the game. And since you start the game with no swans, you'll be picking one of the first two rooms. When you pick a room, you have to connect it to the castle. So let's say I take this second antechamber. And by the way, when you pick something, all the rooms move down and you add another room. So I might connect it like this to the hallway. Now you have to connect it so that it connects to the castle in some matter or format, but because I matched the colors here, I'm also going to get a yellow swan. Now as soon as I put this out, I'm going to put a token of mine on it. Now I built a living quarters room, so on my blueprints, I'm going to put a token here to show that I built one of these. This is just a way for me to keep track of how many of those rooms that I built. Maybe the next person builds this buttery. So they connect it here to the second antechamber. Now they use gray, which is wild. So that matches the purple. And then this player, because they matched, and let's say this was the yellow player, they put this here. Then we both, the red player and the yellow player, are each going to get a purple swan. So matching other players will give them a swan, but it will also give you a swan too. And then maybe the next player, as these move down, decides to build the storage room. They build this storage room here, the green player does, and then both the yellow player and the green player each are going to get a red swan token. But also, because all the entrances are closed, whether they match or not, this room is finished, so the yellow player will turn this token over to show that it's finished, and they get the bonus of whatever that is in that room. In this case, it's going to give them an end of game scoring tile. Sometimes, like this purple room, if all the entrances are filled, you're going to get one of each swan next to the room. This one will give you, at the end of the game, 3 points for each connected staircase. There's just different each staircase you have. Each one is going to give you bonuses. Some, like this forum here, are simply going to give you points at the end of the game, 7 points, if you have the room completed, connecting it. Now, there are other things you can do besides building a room on your turn. You can also build a hallway. Hallways have a lot of connections to them, and their bonus for when you finish them is getting a couple swans. You can also build stairs. Now, stairs have a light end and a dark end. The reason you need stairs is because below ground rooms can only hook up to stairs, the dark end of a stairs, or to another below ground room. And so if you're going to play them at all, you need to do that. So players are going to be building this, and as time goes by, the castle is going to get bigger and bigger, but there's these piles of tiles here. When the first pile is depleted, as soon as players, every time a room is completed, players have to build the moat. They're going to start on one of the sides of the castle or on the other side and put out one moat piece. When the second pile is done, every time a room is completed, you're going to put out two moat pieces, and so you're going to be eventually closing in the castle and finishing up the different walls on the different sides. So this is going to kind of bring a natural end to the game, especially when this third pile is depleted because you're putting out four of them. So eventually the two moats and the two sides will connect to each other, and that's how the game will end. Players can also forego picking a room 2, simply take one of these tiles from here and put it on their architecture board. I want to show you a couple things about this board because a lot of scoring comes from this. At the end of the game, if you have at least one of every room type, you'll get 10 bonus points. 2 of every room type, 20. 3 of every room type, 30. If you get at least 5 of each type, you're going to get 10 bonus points. You also get a free swan when you get 3 of each type. But when you take a room like this, you're going to basically give yourself either a special ability or scoring. Like if I put it here, I get 10 points. It doesn't matter what room I took. I'm just going to get 10 points at the end of the game. This says for one of my bonus tiles, if I tie at the end of the game, I'm going to get points for it. This at the end of the game gives me 3 swans of my choice. This gives me a discount of 1, or if I have both of them, 2 swans when I'm buying tiles on the side of the board. And this, before my turn, I can move 2 moat tiles from one side of the board to the other side of the board. But you can also, instead of picking them, take a bonus tile. So these bonus tiles are pretty simple. They're going to give you points at the end of the game if you have either the fewest or most of something. Fewest yellow swans, fewest red swans, fewest rooms of that type, most downstairs rooms. When you take one of these, you're also going to add it to your board, but you're going to place it like this. And you're going to place it face down. So at the end of the game, people just remember what you had. You'll show it to everybody. But when you put it there, you are not only going to have a chance to score that at the end of the game if you accomplish that goal, but you also stop yourself from getting that special ability. So for each of these slots, you have to decide whether you want the special ability for that slot or if you want to put another scoring tile. You could do all 6 scoring tiles or all 6 special abilities. When the game ends, there's other scoring. You'll notice here at the bottom, for each set of different color swans that you have, you're going to get 10 points. For 4 of the different colors, 7, 4, 2, and 1. You can see those there. And then you're also going to score all the different tiles that you've gotten over the course of the game. And in fact, the game comes with a scoring sheet, and this is where you keep track of all the different points that you get from the different rooms, from your bonus tiles, from your swans, etc. Whoever has the most points is the winner of the game. So I like the way the game looks, you know, building the tiles. It's fun to watch the castle build and build. I will say that there is a lot going on. You can see here, this is a little sample stuff built with all these different tokens. And for some reason, the green feather, every time I see it, I think it's a pickle. But anyway, you can see all this stuff, right? And it's not that it's impossible to see, but it is a little busy, and having the dark water with that sparkling stuff just kind of gives this very busy look to it. Other than that, everything is pretty easy. There's a ton of swans. There is a huge amount of swans, and there's also these. Some locations give you a black swan, which is simply just kind of a random color of one type. And there's also things where you can have the most black swans. And so these tiles, the stack of gold tiles is really high, and so are the water tiles. I actually took some of the tiles and just put them to the side. You can't do that with these tiles here, so woe betide someone sit on that side of the board. It's harder for them to see stuff, so you want to put this in the middle so it doesn't really block people's view. But the game is going to take up a lot of space. I will say, I do like these boards a lot. I like how the tiles fit in here. It shows you the background, so that fits in very nicely. They slide in, or if you're using the gold tile, and it just looks good. Keeping track of everything on here, we found that we were forgetting to keep track a lot of times, but you can always just look at the board and count up how many rooms, and this was a lifesaver at the end of the game. But even still, you can still see that there's like all this symbology. There definitely is a lot of symbols in the game, and while the board looks cool and you can see kind of the castle being built as you place things there, it still does look kind of like a grid. It doesn't look maybe as cool as it could look, but overall, it just does have a very demanding, very, you know, where you look at it and like, wow, what is this game? Table presence. Okay, so, you know, it's an inevitable question. People are going to say, do you like this better? Or do you like Castle of the Mad King Ludwig better? So I'm just going to answer that question straight up. I like castles better. But I'm really not going to be comparing the two of them because, like I said, they're very different games. And even though I do like castles better, I like it a lot, actually. This one I like. It's fun. There's really no reason to do any more comparison other than that. Now, honestly, I would not have picked these similar names. I think it's going to cause some confusion. This game is a really interactive game. Because on your turn, you have a lot of options. I mean, not a ton of options, but you could pick several rooms. And once you have more swans, you have a lot more options. You can pick from any room you want, basically. And you take this room, and you're going to place it in this grid. And you are thinking all the time, as I place it, how many rooms? I got to make sure I leave these doors open so that I can get them all closed so I can score the special bonus of that room. And the bonuses of the rooms range from getting more swans to getting a black swan to getting two swans of your choice to getting points at the end of the game. You know, there's all sorts of things. And who am I connecting to? Because you're almost always connecting. If you connect with yourself, you don't get two tokens, so I don't get two red swans if I connect two red swans together. But if I'm helping, you know, Mandy out, if I connect to hers, I put my tile down, we both get a red swan. And then I put out these other entrances. I'm like, if people connect to all these entrances, I will get swans from them too. So you're thinking the whole time, I'm putting this out, I'm giving other people these points possibly, or at least currency. And once that moat starts coming out and moving around the board, and this is very reminiscent of a game I really enjoyed called Carcassonne the City, where there's a wall that puts it in. This is a very similar thing. And if there's one minor rules nitpick, I thought the way that there was maybe one too many rule about putting the thing out, like it's saying, if you do this, fill an inlet or whatever. It's not as complex as the rules make it seem to be. I just wish it was maybe a little bit more streamlined, but I still like that concept, that moat coming around the outside and shutting the castle in. But this can be done very aggressively, like, oh, you're never gonna finish those rooms. I'm just gonna moat you around there. I'm gonna shut these things down. And that's kind of a really intriguing way also of ending the game too. You can just, okay, you're not connecting these rooms to anything. And you can watch what other people are going for and take tiles. You know, there's a lot of the games, this definitely has this advantage over castles. I know I said I wouldn't compare them, but in castles there was interaction in the buying, but when you built your own castle, here you are definitely watching what everyone else does. And so the board is busy, and it will definitely take you a game to understand the scoring. Yeah, you know you want to collect these swans, but during the game itself you want to spend swans to get things, and is it worth it to spend swans to get the amount of points here? Should I take these special abilities on this blueprint style, or should I go for those bonuses? I will say the bonuses are remarkably easy. Have the most or least of something. You know, in one game I played, I took the least swans for 20 points. That's great, and then I just started spending swans like crazy. But I needed to make sure I was getting enough points because I was going to lose out on a lot of swan points at the end of the game. And the scoring, there's whole sections you won't score from as you're going through the score pad. It's possible you'll have whole areas where you get nothing, but you're getting a lot of points from other ways. Completed rooms, getting the swans, it's an interesting point economy type mix. So I do like the game overall. I like a game that's that interactive, that offers you that many choices, that has a neat theme. I mean, building a palace is a lot of fun. So I do recommend this one. It has, you know, its roots in suburbia and in Castle of Mad King Ludwig. You know, this is, I guess, the third in that trilogy. And it's good. I don't think it's as good as the other two games, but I do like the level of interaction, and it's different. It's not the same thing. So if you're looking for that every time I put something out, like, you're interested in every person's turn. Oh, you're placing a tile? Is it connecting to mine? Are you blocking mine? Are you, ooh, you're moving that there? Oh, I can buy that now. And it offers you good choices. I can build a hallway, I can build stairs, or I can build a room, or I can take a bonus tile, or I can take one of these special things. There's a lot of different, and as the game goes by, those options get more and more, until suddenly that moat starts crossing the thing, then the game starts running out fairly quickly, and you gotta figure out what to do before it ends. So cool, neat. You always wanna build a castle with other people, or a palace, I guess. Check out this game, The Palace of Mad King Ludwig. Dice Tower Judgment approved.
Thanks so much for watching the Dice Tower videos. Find more great videos and reviews, as well as our top-rated audio podcast at Dicetower.com. You can also find other great shows at Dicetowernetwork.com. I'm Eric Summerer, and you've been watching the Dice Tower. The Dice Tower is sponsored by Cool Stuff, Inc., where you can find great games for great prices. Cool stuff in stock. Check them out at CoolStuffInc.com.
Shut the door!
Boo!